Utility Authority. My pleasure to hear him talk. He's got 30 minutes. If we get done early, we'll take a couple of questions and we'll try and stay on schedule.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you for inviting me this afternoon to come speak about some of the work that the Cape Fear Public Utility Authority has been undertaking in response to identifying contaminants in Cape Fear River. And the Cape Fear Public Utility Authority serves the city of Wilmington and the greater part of New Hanover County with water and sewer services. The Sweeney Water Plant is one of two water plants that we operate and serves about 140,000 customers in New Hanover County. So, and our customers have been dealing with this issue for about a year, and that's the idea that there are contaminants in the river, and those contaminants are making their way into the drinking water supply. Okay. So the problem with emerging contaminants is that companies can make new chemicals faster than drinking water regulations, surface water standards, and health science can keep up. So these chemicals can be discharged into the, or manufactured, and their byproducts can be discharged into the environment, and we don't understand what health impacts those might have. And it seems rather intuitive, I'm sure, to every, all of us in here that we need to understand what the health impacts would be before we were to release those into the environment. So perfluorinated compounds, or PFCs like Gen X, are just one type of emerging contaminant, but that's what we're dealing with here in the Cape Fear region now. And just to give a little context, the TSCA, or Toxic Substances Control Act, has 85,000 chemicals registered, and fewer than 10,000 of those have toxicological studies associated with them. Okay, so how is drinking water regulated? It starts at the federal level with EPA, and EPA sets the national the drinking water standards and researches the health effects and establishes new rules. And this makes sense because EPA has the scientists and the health professionals to understand what the health effects of those compounds and chemicals might be across the nation, so that we as consumers can be assured that the water we drink is safe. And then in North Carolina, the Department of Environmental Quality enforces the drinking water standards at the state level, and they implement discharge permits for EPA. And the authority has several discharge permits at our wastewater and water plants also. And those discharges are set as to not impact the downstream designated uses such as public water supplies. So being at the end of the Cape Fear River, our customers and Cape Fear Public Utility Authority has invested heavily in technology over the years. We have a very advanced Sweeney water plant. The Sweeney plant has several advanced technologies, and Dr. Kanepi alluded to that earlier today. And we're still not removing these contaminants. They're very man-made, very robust Teflon, so to speak, contaminants that are not meant to be removed. They're very, very slick. So our Sweeney plant has ozone, biofiltration, UV inactivation or disinfection, and we have a plant staff that has an ingrained culture, like most water treatment professionals, to produce the best water they can possibly produce for their customers. And with all that, we still cannot remove these contaminants, and that is frustrating for us. So one of the ways that EPA, we report our results to EPA, and that helps EPA strengthen their regulations across the nation. And one way that EPA does that is through the Unregulated Contaminant Monitoring Rule, the UCMR. So with that, EPA takes that data for what compounds might exist across the nation, and they evaluate their prevalence, and based on health science, they establish regulations to protect public health, and that makes sense. So every 5 years, EPA uses the unregulated contaminant monitoring rule to identify up to 30 emerging contaminants in water. In 2013, or the UCMR 3, which was between 2013 and 2015, required utilities to test for 6 previously identified PFCs, among other things. And that did not include Gen X, and to date, no regulatory standards have been set for any of those from UCMR 3. The UCMR 4 period will start this fall, and it will include another 30 or so contaminants, including cyanotoxins, pesticides, and metals. But PFCs such as Gen X are not included in the UCMR 4. So once they have this data, they'll determine from a regulatory perspective or from a rulemaking perspective if these contaminants should be regulated to protect public health. So how should we address these contaminants? Controlling these contaminants at the source remains the only option to maintain source and drinking water quality, to be protective of public health. We know from the speakers earlier today that there's PFCs in the groundwater, in the surface water, in the air, in the rain, under the tree canopies. It's in the environment. And protecting it at the source is the only way to protect, to safeguard the environment. It also assures that the discharger pays the cost for removing these from the stream, the environment, and is protective of the downstream communities. And source control makes sense, but in our case, our environment is already polluted. It's already So what's been the regulatory response to all this? EPA assisted with water sampling and analysis, has assisted with water sampling and analysis, and yesterday they held a national leadership summit at US EPA headquarters in Washington, D.C. AWWA was offered 4 positions to participate in that summit and extended one of those positions to the Cape Fear Public Utility Authority. And our Director of Engineering, Carl Vandermeiden, attended that yesterday and presented to the group on the difficulties of testing, identifying, and implementing treatment technologies to remove them from the drinking water. And I think this is one good example of the leadership role that Cape Fear Public Utility Authority is trying to take in response to this issue. DEQ has issued notice of violation to Chemours and required they implement control measures on site, including an air abatement system. And this is good. This is an ongoing process, and we're very thankful for that and the work DEQ is doing. But it seems like it's taking a long time, considering our customers are still drinking the water, and we don't have an answer as to what the additive effects of all these compounds may be. They've also investigated the MPDES permit of Chemours, and they're conducting sampling that's discovered the widespread contamination near the plant. And we do not have guidance yet related in the wake of Gen X for the other perchlorinated compounds that were identified, including the Nafion byproducts 1 and 2 or the compounds identified by the academic communities. The NCDHHS has also done a very good job helping us. They have been helping us to understand the health impacts of these compounds, and they revised the health goal from 71,000 parts per trillion to 140 parts per trillion for Gen X. what's our customer response to perfluorinated compounds been? So the days following the toxic CFD, toxin tank CFD UA Star News article, our organization received a tremendous amount of inquiries from our customers on, you know, they were, and a lot of these questions were being handled through our customer service department. A lot of them escalated up through to managers who could address specific questions that were being asked of us. The number of calls that personally that I took, it's not something that I thought was so noteworthy, but it's the questions that that were being asked and the time that you really had to spend in order to address the concerns of some of our customers. I took calls from expecting mothers and mothers that were breastfeeding, and I took calls from people that weren't even in our service area, but because we had this deadline about CFPUA's toxic water, they wanted to know if we provided them water, and if they lived in the service area that was providing water from the Cape Fear River. And there was just a lot of questions that needed to be answered. I spent, and it's just I'm letting you know that just to give you kind of the perspective. Some of these people, you know, you had to talk to about 30 minutes really and it's not that I could really give them the right answer, but I can tell them what I knew and what we didn't know. And I think once you get all the information out there, it helps to comfort our customers. And so we also use that same strategy somewhat with our website. We're putting all the information on our website, what we know, what we don't know, our water testing results. And it's all out there for anybody that wants to see it. So we received and answered thousands of calls from our customers, and we continue to receive them. We get inquiries, people write statements on their bills when they include that with their payments, and they send them in, and I get questions about why do I have to pay for my water? And 9,400 people are members of the online North Carolina Stop Gen X in our community organizing group. And there's been a tremendous grassroots effort from our community to deal with this issue. And one thing that I hear recurring over and over is that our utility, our ratepayers, should not bear the cost to address source water contaminants that are caused by others. So what's been CFPUA's action to PSCs and drinking water? So we have undertaken regular sampling of the water at Sweeney. We have an aquifer storage and recovery program, which is in its final permitting stages. We had injected the water underground from the Sweeney plant that contained PFCs. We've since removed about 50 million gallons of that water and sent it to our sanitary sewer system. We partnered with UNCW to find out what else is in the river, what's there and how much of it is there. And we've opened two public water stations to give free water to our customers that are concerned. One of the more important things we've done, and I'll talk about this in a later slide, is that we conducted a pilot study at Sweeney to identify what treatment alternatives are available to remove some of these compounds. And we're working with EPA, DEQ, and DHHS to remain informed with the latest information. We have attended the science advisory board meetings and logged in DHHS conference calls. This graph on the left shows that there's a horizontal blue line that shows the 140 parts per trillion advisory for Gen X. And then this graph is of Gen X to the left, of Gen X over about the past year. So you can see those Gen X levels have been declining. But what this graph does not show is the levels of these compounds were much higher. I think Dr. Canapi had on his slide earlier showed what they were. I think the Genex was about 640 parts per trillion at one time. And then the chart on the right depicts all the other PFCs that we've been able to identify in the river. And this chart shows the estimated concentrations also, the ones that we don't have standards for. And the Genex is in the green there, which is about 12% of the total pie. So we understand a little bit about Genex, but we don't know what eating the other 88% of the pie, what effect that might have on us. So this chart includes only compounds we can quantify, and it's about a year's worth of data. And in this area, as Dr. Canapi mentioned, in the beginning there were no standards for many of these compounds, so we were measuring what we could. But as we started to get standards, these columns started getting taller and taller as we could measure more things. And we know this these levels have decreased over time, and they are affected by the Cape Fear River flood, volume in the river as well. So just about a look at our aquifer storage and recovery project. As I mentioned, we pumped about 50 gallons of groundwater from our ASR well. And we pumped that to the sanitary sewer this from September to December 2017. Our ASR April of this year tested 19 parts per trillion for Genex. And we're monitoring groundwater in the vicinity of our ASR well and our Riceville Beach well. Riceville Beach is well number 11, which is very close. And all those groundwater results are less than 140 parts per trillion. I also mentioned we opened two water stations, one at Ogden Park in the northern portion of the county and one at Veterans Park. These are both served by groundwater systems. They've been tested. They're absent of Genex and other PFCs. Okay, so this is one of the pilot test apparatus that we used at Sweeney. This is the one where we put GAC media in these columns. We put filtered water in the top, and this GAC media, as it absorbs these compounds, it gets used up. So what we're doing is we're measuring the amount that we put in the top, we measure the amount that we put in the bottom, we simulate the flow going through the media to determine how long it takes to use this up, how long does it take to break through. So we conducted that at Sweeney on this GAC media and also on the ion exchange resin beads. And ion exchange resin is a similar media that's really very widely used in the manufacturing processes to remove these compounds at locations before they're discharged. And both GAC, we started off with the tabletop exercise. We evaluated reverse osmosis as well, and we ended up piloting GAC and ion exchange resins. And we have not chosen to RO at this point. We've through the testing, although we're still piloting media to determine how it's going to react and when it's ultimately going to break through, we have come to a point where we can make a decision on what technology we need to implement at Sweeney. We did not select RO for that. RO takes quite a bit more, about 15-20% more water than what you're going to put out the door, which actually exceeds our available 7 to 10 or our capacity of raw water at this time. The ion exchange was not chosen. It targets specific compounds. It's designed to target specific compounds, and we got a lot of the cost of GAC and ion exchange were very similar, and the GAC targets a wide spectrum of compounds that it removes, and it also has a lot of second benefits, or removing TOC and EDC and PPC. So we still do not know, but what we still don't know is that academic researchers have detected several PFCs not previously identified in the river, and we don't know much about those. The ones that, that are out there that do not have standards, we don't really know what those concentrations are. We don't know the health effects of all the combined levels of how the different PFCs might react together. We don't know what future regulatory requirements may be for PFCs, and we don't know the impact to commercial and residential markets and to general economic development. To date, our expenses related to GenX have been approximately $1.7 million. House Bill 56 did provide us with $189,000, and we're very appreciative of that. And we're, if adopted, our FY19 operating budget includes $650,000 for legal fees and water quality testing. And so the balance of this cost is paid by our customers. And just as a gauge, $1 billion equals 1.4% increase in water and sewer rates. So this does pressure rates. The final, the treatment strategy report that was developed estimates that upgrading our plant with deep bed contactors with GAC would cost about $46 million, and that $46 million is for concrete, steel, and piping. And then there would be another $2.7 million in annual operating costs, and that's the cost to replace the GAC and additional staffing. To pay for this, the authority would issue bonds paid over 25 years, which would represent about a 7% increase in the total water and sewer bill, which is about $5 per month, or $60 per year. Sewer-only customers wouldn't see that. Water-only customers would pay a little greater amount. So source control is still needed. If levels return to what was seen prior to all of this, plants would be overwhelmed even with the new technology. Our environment's contaminated. And we need to address this at our screening plant. There's nobody else that can address this for our customers. We are taking legal action against the Moores, but I perceive that it will take longer to resolve those legal issues than it will be to build the water plant. So our customers will have to bear those costs, at least in the short term. So what does all this mean? We'll always be at the end of the Cape Fear River. The upstream environment has been contaminated. We've learned over the past year we cannot rely on the regulatory framework, the speed of the regulatory framework. And we need to resolve this for our customers. Our customers have been drinking this water that we learned containing some of these compounds since the early 80s, and this needs to be resolved. So what's next? Earlier this month, we reviewed the treatment recommendations with our board, and we're given the authorization to negotiate a engineering design contract to design treatment infrastructure at our plant improvements to put in these deep bed contactors at SWEAM. We're going to solicit public opinion through our website this summer, and also conduct a workshop with our board in the fall. And then we expect to bring back a design contract for consideration of award in September by our board. That concludes my information, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Several different chemical precipitants.
technology that we chose, and we did pilot this, these media for several, 6 months or so. We're still piloting the media, but the GAC removes a very broad spectrum of these compounds, and not only does it remove DFCs, it's effective at removing both ion exchange and GAC were found to be effective at removing the fluorinated compounds, but it also gives us benefit of lowering our TOC and taking out endocrine disrupting compounds, and pharmaceuticals, and personal care products. So there are a lot of secondary benefits for that. Now, those were, it was primarily selected for the DFC removal, but it just so happened that we got other things along with it with that selection. Now, I'm really not familiar with chemically precipitating for these compounds so much.
I got one more question than any other.
Frank, are you currently feeding in powdered activated carbon or granulated activated carbon that you take for taking those strolls in the game?
We have, but we're not feeding any back, but we have GAC in our existing 14 filters at Sweeney, and that's all that we have. We're also in the process of